Hey friends, if you have business applications that are still running in an IBM or Unisys mainframe environment, you're probably dealing with increasing maintenance costs and a shrinking workforce to keep these applications working. Steve from Astadia is here to show us how you can make Azure your new mainframe by migrating those applications to the cloud today on Azure Friday. Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman and it's Azure Friday. I'm here with Steve Stewart from Astadia and we're talking about the mainframe, which is actually where I got started. I was doing a lot of mainframe work talking to banks running mainframes.
Yep, it's been around for a long time and this is a new era. You know, Azure is a new mainframe.
So Azure is the new mainframe. You know, when I was doing mainframe work, we never really saw them. I think one time I got a tour.
Right.
And I could go and visit the refrigerator.
Yes.
In a big Costco warehouse.
Right.
But that's also the cloud. It's a big mysterious computer I can't visit.
Right, so the mainframe is the granddaddy of cloud. It was the original cloud. Everybody had a terminal connected to something out there in the middle of nowhere. Same thing today. You just RPC in, log into your Azure environment, and that's why Azure's the new mainframe.
Mm-hmm. Now, modernizing those applications sounds like a complicated thing. I would assume most people just don't want to anger the mainframe.
Right.
They just leave it running forever.
Yeah, that's the impression. And what we need to do is kind of educate the folks that there is a new mainframe out there. Azure has a new mainframe. Mm-hmm. And we provide the transition of those mainframe assets into the new mainframe, which is Azure.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is a mainframe application. We've all seen these. They're great because they're fast and they're powerful and they just work.
Right.
So we need our new mainframe to work the same way.
The same way, that's right. This is a standard green screen environment right now that you can see. It's just a standard BMS running on your mainframe.
Mm-hmm.
And then what we can do is just kind of, it's running on Azure. So this is your new mainframe. So we walk you through that transition of taking those assets over there. The process for doing that, this is the mainframe that we're talking about right now,
mm-hmm.
is that we take we do an inventory of everything you have, especially if you have a mainframe that's been around for like 30 years. There's a lot of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Imagine cleaning out your garage that's been there for 30 years. There's a lot of stuff in there. So focus on what drives your business.
Mm-hmm.
So you got to do that assessment of everything that's there and align yourself with the programs that run your business.
Okay, so you do kind of an inventory, an intellectual property inventory.
Mm-hmm.
You say, I've got a bunch of COBOL code.
Mm-hmm.
I probably got a DB2 database.
Right.
And this is the mission critical part of my business.
Right, assembler, all those things.
Mm-hmm.
And then we start doing a mapping, what we call an Azure mapping exercise.
Well, does a mainframe map to the cloud? I mean, is that mapping even possible?
Perfectly, because you built cloud to run Fortune 500 business.
Mm.
The reason the Fortune 500s depend on mainframe because the reality is they don't crash as often.
Mm-hmm.
So you have built a framework, equivalent framework, SQL Server, if it blows up, it recovers. There's all these recovery functions that have been in all the investments that you guys have been doing over the years. You've created a mainframe equivalent in the cloud.
You know, I think it was Thomas Watson from IBM who said that there was a market for maybe 5 machines, and I think that he thought there'd be basically a mainframe on each continent.
Right.
But now we have like 20 or 30 data centers all over the place.
Right.
Theoretically, if I move my mainframe application to the cloud, I'm gonna get more availability and basically virtual mainframes all over the world.
Anywhere. So if I'm a small business owner, have a mainframe application that my market just happens to be North America because that's where my mainframe is,
mm-hmm.
imagine going to the cloud and be able to open up the world. You don't need to buy a mainframe in different countries. You just install it on that data center. So we're seeing a big interest in the ISV market,
mm-hmm.
To move some of that workload over.
Okay. Is this something where you're getting code reuse and database reuse like in the 90%? How much new code am I going to have to write?
Well, you don't have to write a lot of new code because the path that we're talking about is taking the existing COBOL and DB2, mapping that over to Azure SQL, and then to a new COBOL, Micro Focus COBOL.
Okay.
And Micro Focus is not new, it's been around for 40 years, but the newer versions, it's a managed code set. It's .NET. So you're able to consume classes and you can create classes within your COBOL to be leveraged. So if you look at your digital journey, I'm a CEO, I'm hearing all about AI and Power BI and all this analytics stuff, but all my stuff is in COBOL and green screen. Transition it over, it's down to the CLR level. I can then call AI, do machine learning, I can do all those things. You have all this dormant data that exists on the mainframe that now is exposed. You don't have that today in your ZOS.
Mm.
You do have it when you go to Azure. So that gives you the agility.
That's exciting. So you're using COBOL, you're talking to the .NET framework in the future, .NET Core.
Right.
You've been brought into the future, but all that intellectual property in your COBOL code is maintained.
Your business rules, everything that you currently have, are there and now can be exposed and leveraged.
Did you have a diagram that shows that mapping?
Let me kind of show you. This is what a mainframe looks like for the folks who've never seen the mainframe. But here's the mapping of it, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what we currently have is that, everything on the top, and the goal is we do an Azure mapping. So we do, what do you have on a mainframe? I have Security RackF. Okay, we're going to use Azure AD and LDAP for that. And a lot of times it's role-based security, so we'll also leverage Azure SQL to provide all of those things. You know, we're here to replicate functionality, not duplicate it. Mm-hmm. So you have Assembler. Why are you using Assembler? Oh, we did this as a routine. Okay, we don't need it. We have a .NET widget that we can leverage here. And we do that mapping. And once that mapping is done, then we compile and start testing. We have to validate that the transition was there. There's a lot of, you know, EBCDIC to ASCII things that we deal with, but all that comes through the testing. And once you're done, give you the keys, you're running on Azure, and away you go.
I love that some of the younger people who are watching are going to have to look up EBCDIC and figure out what that means, EBCDIC to ASCII. Now, this also, I'm thinking from a modernization perspective, once it's moved to Azure, once it's moved to a COBOL running on .NET, a Micro Focus COBOL running on .NET, I could put a REST, a modern REST API
yes.
on top of my mainframe application,
yes.
couldn't I?
Yes, and that so stuff is totally supported. So depending on what you want to do, it's not, you know, you don't have to kill the mainframe. You can move a lot of the stuff and leverage things that are on the mainframe, right? Microsoft has got a product HIS as part of the BizTalk group that supports that, so you can definitely leverage that. Mm-hmm. And then also you can do the big bang, move everything on down. So really it's how the clients want to do this, and that's what we're seeing.
Yeah, we had a great Azure Friday episode on integration services environments where yep. you could put together a virtual network and have Azure talk to your mainframe. So I like what you just said, that there's the realization that we're not saying abandon the mainframe,
right.
we're saying modernize.
Right, modernize it. So you can leave stuff up there, bring things down. I had a client that's going to keep all their assemblers on the mainframe and move all the COBOL down. Mm-hmm. So it's like an extension. Mm-hmm. So you have a hybrid environment of your mainframe and Azure. And that's what the world's going today.
Well, what's nice about that is the acknowledgement that reality is a hybrid and that it's not always going to be clean.
Right.
Sometimes it's going to be a combination of these different things, but they all work well together. We're really standing on the shoulders of giants.
That's correct. I mean, that is really funny. If you look at what's inside the Azure framework, there's a lot of mainframe qualities within. And that's why you're able to do a lot of these things. So it's, you know, back to the points, it's very important that once you do this transition, treat it like a mainframe. Mm-hmm. Just because you move it to one VM and the VM blows up, then, oh, well, the cloud doesn't work. Well, if you don't architect it like a mainframe, you know, this is an example of how we do this, where we leverage Azure Traffic Manager with multiple regions to give you that fault tolerance type capability that exists on a mainframe. Leverage Azure SQL replication services, right? And those types of things. So we have it, you know, using the Azure Load Balancer, Azure Traffic Manager, and multiple regions. So mainframe class architecture mm-hmm. that exists in Azure, and that's what we're providing. Actually, you're providing that.
Yeah, yeah,
we're
yeah.
leveraging that.
Right. Astadia is providing the tools and the services and the partnership
right.
to go ahead and make that. So
that's correct.
It sounds like Microsoft has partners that can help you make this happen, like Astadia.
Mm-hmm.
And this isn't something that's like new or cutting edge. You've done this hundreds of times.
We've done this, a couple hundred times, and we're seeing a lot of interest right now. We're really busy on that. But, you know, Microsoft has an eye on the ball here as well. You know, Bob Ellsworth from Microsoft is dedicated, got a mainframe team on this. They've got a lot of mainframe folks that works on that group, and they're dedicated on, you know, helping you transition some of these things over. And they have a partner ecosystem that I leverage, and I'm proud to be one of those. And that's their role.
That's exciting. I think that means that really the work now is just getting the word out.
Getting the word out.
Someone out there feels locked into their mainframe.
Right.
They feel uncomfortable about that.
Right.
They're hearing cloud everything,
right.
and they think that their work needs to be rewritten.
Right.
As opposed to migrated.
They don't have to rewrite it. So let me tell you a secret. You own a mainframe. Microsoft has an IBM mainframe. And they do development, and that's how they support HIS.
See, I want to visit it. There's a giant IBM refrigerator.
It's in campus somewhere. Yeah. So, but you know, that just shows you the investment and the dedication of Microsoft to talk about how to transition those workloads over.
Mm-hmm.
But if you look at, you know, like I said, I want to go to AI and Power BI, they think they have to rewrite everything. They don't.
So that's interesting also, that there's technologies like AI, like facial recognition, like all the different things that machine learning and AI could mm-hmm. provide you that were not as mature or didn't exist 40
right.
years ago. You're telling me that I can take a mature mainframe application
right.
and now AI enable it.
Right. Let's talk about a company who wants to authenticate users. They have the John Doe and they know what the person has, and you just add a JPEG of a picture of that. Then you mm-hmm. leverage on the Azure framework to scan all those facial recognitions and associate that key with that name. So when you go into the front of a camera,
right.
it shows you who you are.
You're effectively getting Windows Hello into your mainframe application.
Into your mainframe application is pretty easy, and that's a very simple example.
Mm-hmm.
And before we had to write everything in C# and do all this stuff, right now I just take it, I just call it as a class. It's a class.
Mm-hmm. The applications that we think of as mainframe applications are usually terminals, whether it be VT100 or whatever. Do they remain that way, or is that really up to us as the migration?
It's up to you. It's your digital journey, right? So the first thing we try to do, if you go from a proprietary computing model to a commodity-based computing model, the cost differences are almost 60% to 70%.
Okay.
Running mainframe workloads on those. So the first thing you want to do is rapid exit. Then you look at, do I want to change the UI? Mm-hmm. Now, there's arguments to be said that, you know, there's super users that can tab really quickly and
I
do a lot of
text mode frankly is underrated,
right? So you can, they can go into really quickly, so you really don't want to impact the productivity of your super SMEs that are out there. So it depends. If it's a end user, right, I log in and do some sort of a call, and you don't want to give them a green screen, you may want to do a nice UI. So you do that assessment as phase two, but the first thing you want to do is move everything quickly. My suggestion is don't go and do UI for everybody, because you're going to impact the productivity of your super users with macros and all that stuff.
That's true. It's also worth pointing out, just as an aside, that Windows 10 has made huge improvements in the console. There's now VT100, SSH built in. You can get those terminal UIs, and those existing power users can have a great terminal experience while you work on designing something else potentially.
That's correct.
Yeah, or even plugging in, I suppose, mobile applications?
Mobile applications are fine. You can do HTML5, so you have different types of real estate to work with, and you know, different iPads or whatever Android devices you currently have. So you're able to take your mainframe applications and have that. And then work on the screens too.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of things you can do with that.
So once I've got it into Azure, it's in Azure. It's not necessarily special. It's just yet another Azure application. So then all the Azure things, logic apps and batch and everything becomes available to
me. It's Azure native.
Mm.
I was writing a C# because it's down to the CLR level. It's a managed code set, which, by the way, is a JV between Microsoft and Micro Focus that provided that. And your IDE is Visual Studio. You can leverage TFS. So you look at how you're bringing in all of the older technologies to the newer technologies. And that's all ready to go.
I think you had a screenshot where you showed Visual Studio, but also people using Eclipse.
That's correct. So, you know, the investment that, you know, our partner Micro Focus is one of the tools that we use, been around a long time. Mm-hmm. They support both Eclipse and Visual Studio. So if you look at, you know, the old days, I can't find COBOL programmers. And this, what happened is that they would take them to the green screen tab. I need you to, this is your new job.
Yeah.
And they understand Eclipse or Visual Studio, and they kind of go, whoa, where's my mouse? And there's no mouse, it's, you tab over a couple times and he has a little X kind of going back up and down. But if I go and give them a Visual Studio with IntelliSense, I can hover over, you know, see the values and all those things that exist within Visual Studio. That's a really good programmer on Visual Studio with all the COBOL plugins can read the code.
Yeah.
Because COBOL is move value here. You know,
it's
not a hard language to pick up. So I'm always in the camp that I can find COBOL programmers. They're the C# guys coming out of school.
Yeah.
Because I put them in a quick boot camp and they're ready to go.
Fantastic. Well, there's a lot of guys and gals out there that are doing work in COBOL that can then find a new modern experience in the cloud, and they can assist, as well as younger people that are coming out that can easily pick up something like this in an environment that they're familiar with.
Right.
So where can people learn about this?
Well, in Microsoft, there's a site that that's up there. It's azuremicrosoft.com migration. Is there? There's a dedicated site with all the ecosystem white papers and things like that.
Mm-hmm. And it looks like migrate@microsoft.com is a distribution list that is dedicated to finding out what partners, what tools that you can use.
Fantastic. That's correct.
Thank you so much, Steve Stewart from Astadia.
Appreciate it.
I am learning all about how to migrate my mainframe applications to the cloud today on Azure Friday.